Rob Woodall.
Hello, it's nice to meet you, Mr. Woodall.
You're getting more press than all of the elected candidates combined out here these days.
Oh, that's
well, that's good news or bad news. I don't know the answer to that, but it's bad when I can recognize you more easily than you can recognize all of us.
Well, thank you for introducing yourself.
I just
want
to say hello.
Okay.
Thank you very much. Good evening. How are you?
Congressman, how are you?
Well, Mr. Chairman.
Did you do 7th District too? But you didn't write the 7th District.
Large map that actually has the streets as far as the congressional.
Oh, it does. Well, that's a new one.
No. And so look at all those stuff there. Well, it's about split.
It's been hard to get.
Yeah,
that's right.
It is. But I think most of the time, how are you?
Yeah, they are. They get that.
Oh, we have product on that too.
No.
Hey there, how are you?
I'm good.
I'm over in Underwood.
I appreciate you coming very much.
Probably closest to.
I was saying, you tell me what the internal politics are here. What the chair is supposed to be.
Why don't you sit here?
Welcome. It is 6:30, so if we may, everyone take their seats and we'll begin the debate.
Good evening. My name is Ethan Underwood. I have the pleasure of serving as chairman of the Forsyth County Republican Party, and I want to welcome you to tonight's debates between congressional candidates. As you know, we have two new congressional districts that were drawn as a result of the redistricting process from the census. And in fact, I want to thank Representative Mark Hamilton's office for getting us copies. In fact, I see them in the back of the room. He got us copies of the map. Several folks have been saying, well, I don't know which district I'm in. I don't know where it runs along the street level. So this is the best map that we have available and have acquired that from Mr. Hamilton. So thank you for getting that for us. I hope that you'll take an opportunity to review that as you walk around during the debates or after the debates. We are pleased to have with us candidates for both the 7th and the 9th Congressional District. We'll be beginning our debate shortly with 7th District candidates. But as always, we like to begin our meetings with an invocation and the Pledge of Allegiance. So if you would please stand as you're ready. Lord, we're thankful for our country and the opportunity to vet candidates, to consider men and women who would put themselves forward as our representatives. We pray that you give our community wisdom, give our candidates courage, and give us your blessings in all that we do. Bless our country, be with those who are in harm's way, and give our many sins. In Christ's name, amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Excellent. We are pleased to have with us tonight our 7th District candidates. We have joining me on my left, Mr. David Hancock, and then also we have our incumbent Congressman, Mr. Rob Woodall. Please help me welcome him. Gentlemen, we have the Forsyth County Republican Party's Executive Committee has developed questions that they asked for you. I'll honestly be the first to admit I was a little sad when we were developing the questions. As we develop these questions for candidates, we often say, well, this branch of government, they don't deal with this. And this branch of government doesn't deal with this. And the sad part of it is our limited federal government has really gotten to the point where it deals with everything. So I'll promise you tonight with the questions, they're all, they deal with a menagerie of topics, from social issues to defense issues to taxation issues. The purpose of it is for the electorate, folks who are watching on the internet, folks who are here in person, to get to know you, get your stance and your position on where we should be going, what our congressmen ought to be saying on our behalf in the halls of Congress. We have a copy of the rules before you. For those in the audience who are not familiar, Each candidate will be given 2 minutes to introduce himself or herself, state why they're running for office, and to address the issues that are important to the candidate. Once we get through the 2 minute introductions, we'll move to the debate phase. And this will be a round robin style debate. We'll ask a question, and each candidate has 1 minute to respond. His opponent then responds, and then we go back through. So each candidate will have 2 minutes to answer each question. But the intent is to create a dialogue so that you're able to respond to your opponent's responses. Our timekeeper, Ms. Amanda Nixon, is sitting up here in the front. Please keep an eye on her. She will give you a signal when you have 1 minute, 15 seconds, and when your time is up. We do have a rule that no mobile devices or texts be used during the debate. And then finally, at our closing stage, each candidate will have 1.5 minutes to make their closing remarks. With that, I think we'll start with Mr. Hancock. You have 2 minutes to give your opening remarks.
Okay, thank you, and thank you to all of you who came out tonight to learn more about your candidates. My name is David Hancock, and I graduated in 1983 from Auburn University with a degree in computer engineering, and I moved to Atlanta, where I met my wife, who's now a wife of 25 years. In 1997, I met a couple of Georgia Tech graduates, and together we formed a company, ACP. It's a software company. We sell computer software around the world. I'm serving as the chief operating officer of the company. Over the last 5 years, we've averaged about 20% growth, which is pretty good, especially in this economy. During the 30 years that I've lived and worked in this district, I have seen a gradual shift away from some of the principles that are defined and laid out in the Constitution. 2 years ago, I was encouraged when we elected a majority of Republican in the House of Representatives, and yet, here we go with all spending bills originating in the House, and yet we find ourselves $2 trillion further in debt. I believe at this point that all we need to do is some drastic change, and that's the only way to get us out of this crisis. I don't think we need people who know Washington so much. We need people who, citizens who are willing to go to Washington and make the hard choices. The founders knew the limits of the Constitution were vital because they realized that people have an inherent thirst for power, and without that, those constraints are going to go outside the bounds of what they should be doing. Serving in Congress is not really a hard job. The powers delegated by the Constitution to the federal government are few and defined. Those which remain in the state governments are numerous and indefinite. There'll be questions tonight that I can't answer. I've been running a business here in Georgia. But I tell you, as COO, I get hard questions every week that I can't answer. And when that comes up, what I do is I take a look at the issues, I do research, I find out all the facts I can, and then I make a basic decision based on the principles. That's exactly what I intend to do if I go to Congress. There's a Georgia representative who I like to follow him all up. Before every question that comes up for him, he asks, is it law? Is it constitutional? Does it reduce the size and scope of federal government? And does it increase personal liberty for you? I'll make all my decisions based on the answers to those questions.
Congressman Woodall.
Thank you. I appreciate all you all being out here tonight, too. I mean, the truth of the matter is here in the most conservative county in the great state of Georgia, the question is, why don't we have even more folks out here tonight? And one of the things that's on my list is, Rob Woodall, your very first term congressman, came in that big freshman class last year, is what can we do to rebuild some of the trust between the electorate and the elected? If you go out and ask around today, I hope what you'll hear about me, I hope you'll hear conservative, I hope you'll hear principled, I hope you'll hear all of those things about what happens in Washington. But even more importantly, I hope you hear accessible. I hope you hear available. I hope you hear here with us instead of there with them. Because Washington is only effective if your member of Congress is carrying your voice to Washington. Carrying your member of Congress's voice to Washington is an easy job. Carrying the district's voice to Washington is much harder. We've worked hard at that. I tell you, the only reason I got in this race 2 years ago, it was an 8-person primary for the 7th District, is I didn't hear anyone talking about serving individuals. Heard a lot of folks talking about what they do in Washington, D.C. I didn't hear anybody talking about how it was they were going to make a difference in individuals' lives back home. I'll tell you, that service aspect of this job is something that I've prioritized in my 18 months, and something I'll continue to prioritize if you all send me back in November. Liberty and service are the two touchstones by which I run my office and conduct your business. I ask folks not to evaluate me based on the new laws I pass for you. Evaluate me based on the old laws that I repeal. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Joe. Well, we're now moving to our debate phase. We'll begin with Mr. Hancock. You have 1 minute to respond. Mr. Hancock, we are expecting a decision from the Supreme Court regarding Obamacare data. If Obamacare is not found unconstitutional, how will you, as a member of Congress, respond?
I think this goes back to the powers that are given to each branch in the Constitution. And I'm afraid that the executive branch has overstepped the boundaries of the Constitution. I know the congressman here has been on the team to try to bring the bills to repeal Obamacare or the Affordable Health Care Act. And so far, it has not been successful because of the blocking of the Senate. I hate to have a constitutional crisis, but there comes a point where every section of government, every branch of government not only has to make sure that it's abiding by the rules that set the Constitution, but it's got a responsibility to check and make sure every other branch is abiding by the rules of the Constitution. And if this country has gone to the point where the executive branch can make a dictate that requires people to do something just for existing, I think we've come to a very bad place, and it's going to take a lot of thought and a lot of serious decisions to make that go away.
Congressman Woodall, do you need me to repeat the question?
Yeah, I don't need to. Thank you. Very first major vote I cast with the 7th District's voting card was the complete repeal of the President's health care bill. And the House passed that in January of 2011, and absolutely nothing has come up in the Senate since that time. It is going to take a change in the Senate, and it's going to take a change in the White House to do away with the President's health care bill if we can't get it done in the Supreme Court. But what is of concern to me is, and we see it in the polling these days, middle-class American voter after middle-class American voter, so-called conservative after so-called conservative says, you know what, I really like a lot of it. I don't like the mandate, but I like a lot of the other material. Our job, leading from one of the most conservative districts in the country, is to say no. I don't care how much you like it. We don't have to do it in Washington, D.C. There is not one thing that's in the President's health care bill beyond the unconstitutional mandate that Commissioner Ralph Hudgens and Mark Hamilton couldn't do under the Gold Dome instead of us doing it in Washington, D.C. And I promise you they do a better job.
The Congress made an excellent speech on the floor of the House a little while ago on HIPAA. And I don't know how you actually saw that. But he made the point exactly like he's saying. Georgia, that law passed years ago, it's Sunday Bill Clinton, wasn't it? Allowed the federal government to already work within the confines that it had to modify the insurance policies that it regulates. The states already have the powers to do that as well. The concern I have is the same as yours. Congress passed, said, no, we're going to repeal that, that's as far as it goes. Without a change in Congress, without a change in the Senate, without a change in administration, I don't see it going away. I mean, there are a lot of alternatives that have been forward. Look at the presidential primary we just had. A lot of good ideas came out of that. Some of those ideas could be taken and used. But it's got to be a private system where citizens have the responsibility.
You know, you think about the problems the president said he was trying to solve. He was trying to solve rising costs, and he was trying to solve limited access. I identify exactly those same problems in our healthcare system in America. Though he went in exactly the wrong direction to solve it. He went in the direction of more command and control from Washington, D.C., instead of more private involvement between doctors and patients. Have you thought about why it is the two highest areas of inflation in this country, healthcare inflation and college education inflation, are the two areas in which the federal government is the most financially involved? Government is not the solution to any of our healthcare problems, but it is the cause of the lion's share of them.
This next question, Woodall. President Obama has refused to enforce the Defense of the Marriage Act and has issued an executive order stating that his administration will not deport people brought to the U.S. illegally as children. Is the executive branch treading upon legislative powers, and if so, what do you believe to be done about it?
Well, even the answer is the executive branch is absolutely treading on legislative powers, but it didn't start with the Obama administration, and that's where we bear more responsibility. None of us were in Congress in 2001 when President George Bush was sworn in. But one of the very first things he did was to say, you know what, I don't like these environmental regulations that the last Congress passed, so I'm just going to instruct EPA not to enforce them. And Republicans said, good for you, Mr. President, good for you. My job as your congressman is not to be a cheerleader for a Republican president. My job as your congressman is to be the defender of the United States Constitution. And what the Constitution worries about is not a tyrannical Congress, but a tyrannical executive. We are in this spot we're in today with the president because 6 years of Republican Congresses did zero oversight on a Republican president. It was wrong for them to give him a pass. It was wrong for Nancy Pelosi to give Obama a pass. And I will not give Mitt Romney a pass.
Mr. Hancock.
That's the same answer. Each branch of government should not only actively defend its own constitutional powers, but challenge the constitutional authority of other branches. And that's exactly where we are today. We've got an overreach, and we have a Supreme Court decision that just came out. And I'm greatly concerned for our country. I'm just an average citizen who decided that, you know, I've been involved in politics for years and years, and now it's time to have a chance to get up there and put my money where my mouth is, so to speak. And so that's what I did. I made myself available because I'm concerned. The more I read, the more I learn about the Constitution, the more I see what's happening with the erosion of powers of the various Congress is becoming irrelevant, and that's just an absolute disaster. Congress is where the power should be. Each branch has its own functionality. And I just felt like I've got to get out there and at least be a voice to try to bring us back to a constitutional democracy.
You know, elections have consequences. We all know someone who went out and voted for President Obama because they wanted to cast an enlightened vote in the last election. They wanted to be a part of making history in the last election. Well, they have made history. They've made history with the largest expansion of federal government, even including the New Deal. They've made history with the largest expansion of deficits and debt that we've seen since World War II. Elections have consequences, and that's why I'm glad David's in this race. I'm glad that we have choices. Elections only work if you have choices from which you can choose. It is not easy to put your name on the line. But when you talk about what can you do to push the executive branch into doing its job, the answer is absolutely nothing short of cutting out every penny of funding that you send in their direction. It is the American people's job to ensure the right president sits in the White House.
I think the Congressman is exactly right. The Congress controls the purse strings, not only for spending, but for authorization, but for borrowing. And it could be that, like when the debt limit came up last year, it could have been Congress should have said, no, sorry. I don't know where that would have left us. We're both on the same issue on extreme concern for the country if the current administration gets back in power. I'm more concerned not so much for the effects that they will have over the next 4 years, but for the fact that as Americans, we look around, see the state of everything, and we decide to vote the administration back in. That says worse about our country than the fact that we've got another administration we have to deal with in 4 years.
Well, in that regard, I'll ask Mr. Hancock, should the debt limit be increased again?
I'm going to say no. I know that there was a big discussion and concern about defaulting debt, but there were several ways around it. Very simple law that could have been a House resolution that could have been passed that would have said that prioritize spending on your debt rather than anything else. 43% of the budget right now is consumed with entitlement programs. If you're adding in like housing or urban development and family lunch programs and stuff, you're up over 50%. That has to be addressed. That has to be changed as well. The discretionary spending, you know, the programs are just going to have to say, I'm sorry, we'd love to do that, but we just don't have the money. And so I would vote for saying no on the debt limit. I know that there were some issues last year. There was a promise of a balanced budget amendment, which, you know, you can't trust those people, you know, because then they come up with an amendment that's not really quite exactly what we're looking for. So I would say a long answer, short answer, no.
There is absolutely no set of circumstances where I vote for an increase in the debt ceiling without some sort of associated serious today cuts. But the debt ceiling is just a piece of legislative language. It doesn't save America a penny. And that's important. Everybody in here is getting Social Security. If we don't raise the debt ceiling, you might not get your Social Security, though we do both support legislation that would prioritize those payments and debt and interest payments above so many other payments. But if you don't get your check, we still owe you the money. It doesn't save a penny. The debt limit comes when our friends, so-called friends, in China and in Germany refuse to lend us another dime. And that debt limit is coming. Anyone who runs a small business knows when your creditors won't give you money, it's when you hit your debt limit. The debt limit vote that we took last year was the only bill in Congress that cut trillions from future liabilities. We cut trillions in that bill, and I thought it was important to support.
Mr. Hancock, any response? I think I would disagree. I think I would have said, I would draw a line in the sand and said, we've let you have $15 trillion, and that's what you've got to work with, and that's all you've got. If you look at when I was born in the 60s, early 60s, the government was spending about $10,000 per household, right? And you can see why, as the country expands, there's going to be more households. Well, now they're spending about, in inflation-adjusted dollars, about $30,000 per household. So, you know, go back a couple of years and go back to even 2008 spending levels, and you could make a huge dent instead.
Mr. Woodall? You know, who'd have thought with President Obama in the White House and Harry Reid leading the United States Senate, we would have cut discretionary spending, not the funny Washington, D.C. math, but discretionary spending fewer dollars in 11 than we did in 10, fewer dollars in 2012 than we did in 11, and be on track to spend less in 2013 than we did in 12. That's what this Congress has been able to do, this U.S. House has been able to do, the Senate has been fighting us on that. It's 3 yards in a cloud of dust for me to save this country. The president is not going to sign the bill that you and I all want the president to sign. We've got to take what we can get and bank it.
Very good, gentlemen. Congressman Woodall, do you support gay marriage? Would you support an amendment? And it's a two-part question. One, do you support gay marriage? And two, would you support an amendment to the U.S. Constitution requiring that only heterosexual marriages between two people be the only marriages recognized in the United States?
I do not support gay marriage, and I would not support a constitutional amendment to make that clear. This is a big question for conservatives. My gripe with liberals is debates they can't win here in Georgia, they take to Washington, D.C., and try to win them there. That's wrong. But the same thing is true of conservatives. Debates that we can't win in California, we should not take to Washington, D.C., and nationalize them there. Marriage has been a state-regulated issue for the entire history of this country. I've got great ideas about how to make America better and how to make Americans happier, but I will not be passing federal legislation to do that. I'll be teaming up with Jack Murphy and Mark Hamilton to pass state legislation to do that. We do not need more laws in Washington, no matter how much we might agree with them.
To repeat the question?
No, I don't. Exact same thing. Completely personally against any kind of married man should be between a man and a woman. But exactly like the Congressman, this is not something that belongs in the Constitution. Take a look at the Constitution, see what it says. It talks about the powers of the judicial branch, power of the federal, executive branch, and the power of the congressional. And that is not something that fits in there anywhere. It's a social issue and definitely should be up to the states. And Georgia wouldn't have a problem, I don't think, passing it. I would love to work with Georgia on that. I work with Georgia politics for a lot at the county level, at the state level, and that's something I'd be happy to champion. But my goal, one of my goals for my 4 years, or 2 years, hopefully 2 years in Washington, is to get as much of the federal government out, to reduce the size and scope of the federal government. It's in everything we do, and it shouldn't be in the government as well.
Congressman Hamilton.
Well, you know, where the money is where the power is. And I get this meeting all the time. My office folks come up from Georgia and they say, Rob, we'd really like you to fund X, Y, or Z program for us. And I say, how about if we just cut your taxes and then we go down to the gold dome and have the conversation about whether or not we want to raise and fund that money in Washington. Whether it's questions of morality or whether it's questions of priority, I tell you, we will always make better decisions here. I can count, even in our Republican majority, the 22 liberal Republicans who would defeat a conservative agenda, not so under the gold dome.
He makes an excellent point. That's the reason the Constitution is set up, is to keep people from putting their bias in and to keep people from the thirst for power. Government wants to grow. People have told me,
Government should be run like a business. I run businesses. I don't think government should be run like a business. A business's goal is to grow and to expand and to get bigger. Government's job is not doing it. The government is a very limited and finite role. So the tax code is exactly an example of that. He talks about taking money and sending it back to Washington so it comes back here. The best thing would be to keep the money here. But the government of Washington loves to have the control. With the income tax, they can make anything happen by simply changing the tax code. Thank you.
Next question, Mr. Hancock. What are your top legislative priorities in the next Congress?
I think the top three things. I think Congress could spend an entire year, or an entire, maybe 2 years, but certainly an entire year doing only three things. Solving the entitlement problem, because everybody knows it's a problem. Everybody knows it's getting bigger, and that can't keep getting down the road. But what happens is every year we put that off, we come about $1 trillion more debt. We've got a lot of proposals for that, and that's something I certainly can't do in the remaining 45 seconds. I don't even know what they all are. Cutting spending would be number two. Not raising the debt anymore, just go ahead and making the hard cuts, and if people don't like it, I'm sorry, but I think the world would respect it. America could lead. America could bring the world out of a recession, but first we have to get our financial house in order, and then reducing the size and scope of the federal government. So those three issues are where I'm focusing everything I have. Getting back to a constitutional republic is defined by the founding fathers.
Congressman Woodall, what are your top legislative priorities in the next Congress?
Well, I'm going to put cutting spending in that larger category. I serve on the budget committee. We have passed the only budgets in United States history that have cut $6 trillion plus dollars in a year. Can't get the president to sign off on them. But we're taking those votes, and we're preparing members to do that. If we have president and Senate to work with, we could do the spending side of that ledger. My top individual legislative priority is the fair tax. I'm a big believer that the fair tax solves so much of what ails us in Washington. It sends the power from Washington back to those of us back home. We've done more on the fair tax these past 18 months than we've been able to do on the fair tax the past 10 years. And we want to continue that growth next time around. Number two, small legislative priority is the Competitive Elections Act that I introduced. We need more people sitting on this stage to give you more choices. My job is not to scare other candidates away. My job is to beat the other candidates who turn out with better ideas. Competitive Elections Act, by taking away the power of incumbents, is going to put more people on this stage. I think that goes a long way to saving that.
Mr. Hancock, would you like to expand?
Well, I would be on board with any of those issues. Competitive Election Acts, do you realize I'm just an average businessman. It cost me over $5,000 simply to run for Congress. And then I'm facing a congressman who's got a lot of money left over, relatively speaking, from a previous election. So it makes it very, very difficult for an incumbent who wants to win to not win. I mean, it's a pretty easy race for them to do. But I agree with him. I was hoping to have 20 people running for this election. There's enough people in this district. There's 500,000 registered voters in the 7th district. You think there'd be people who would say, you know, whatever, I'm going to get up there and I'm going to do what I can to save the country.
And along those lines, I mean, we have gotten into the mode where elections are about, he's a snake in the grass, and that's why I want to defeat him. It's not the election I was involved in last time. I had eight people in the race with me that I thought were fine Americans. I just thought their priorities were different from my priorities, so we got to have a debate about 7th District priorities. Fair tax has to be one of those priorities. More original co-sponsors this year than any year before. Language in the budget report for the first time ever. First hearing in the Ways and Means Committee in 10 years. We can make this happen.
Just next question. Got by Congressman Will. Would you support the repeal of the 17th Amendment, which allows for the direct election of senators? Why or why not?
I would absolutely support the repeal of the 17th Amendment. We talk about that in the Republican Study Committee. That's the group of the most conservative members of Congress. How it is that we bring that out. 17th Amendment, direct election of senators, it was passed in a time of great corruption in Washington, where they believed Standard Oil was buying and paying for senators, where they believed that your folks in the railroads were buying and paying for senators by buying and paying for state legislators. But the accountability today of state legislators is so much more than it is of federal legislators. I could hide in Washington, D.C. You should defeat me if I did, but I could. You can't hide as a state legislator. You think the 10th Amendment would be in the danger that it is? Do you think it would have disappeared states' rights would have disappeared if state legislators still elected our United States senators? Do you think our United States senators would be as difficult to contact if they were named by our state legislators? Big yes for me.
I'll go with yes too. A lot of people don't realize that when the Constitution was set up, the House was elected for a 2-year term and the senators were appointed by the state legislature. I know that I go down to the Capitol all the time. I meet my state representative, I see him at the grocery store, exactly like you're saying. So that is where the accountability. I've honestly never thought about repealing the 17th Amendment, but I see that as a way to get more and more of the power back to the states, the purpose of the Senate, give back to the purpose, the original purpose of the Senate.
You know, the people of Nevada just spoke, and Harry Reid won. So he's going to be there for another 6 years, well, another 4 years now. What would that election have looked like if the Nevada legislature had named the senators? What do term limits look like if our legislators are naming those senators? It's a sensitive topic because it takes the vote away from us as individuals. And the question is, who do you think you exert more influence over? Saxby Chambliss and Johnny Isaacson, or Mark Hamilton? Saxby Chambliss and Johnny Isaacson, or Jack Murphy? Who's more accountable to you? And if you believe it's your local representatives, 17th Amendment appeals to you.
Goes back to the more people in the election thing. You know, you mentioned Harry Reid, you could say Nancy Pelosi, you could say a number of senators and representatives. I don't even think we should know their names. I mean, these are people that come in there, ideally for a term or two, do their duty as servants to the people in New York. It has become such a, I was watching a video one time, and I saw Charlie Rangel walking into a building. And he was walking toward a door with an entourage around him, and he wasn't even gonna come close to opening the door. It was clear that he was expecting someone to run around, open the door, which they did. That's just become a scary professional politician.
Sorry for the anecdote.
No, that's great. All right, Mr. Hancock, we'll do that. What role should the federal government take in the provision of public education?
Significantly less than we are now. You know, I've known Congressman Woodall for a while, and it's not going to be very exciting because the bulk of our animosity, if you will, our concern is with the current administration. I think we're going to be on the same page on this one pretty much. The federal government, you know, right now they're way beyond even setting standards. They're collecting money from the states and they're sending it back to the states for the states to spend. I think that should be, education should be a local issue. And whether states want to do vouchers or whatever it is the states want to do, the states should be able to do that. The federal government, I don't see anywhere in the Constitution where it talks directly about educating children in the states. Let's let the states do it. So I think the federal government should have significantly less, if any at all.
There's no county in the state that is moving towards excellence faster than is Forsyth County. There are going to be no finer schools in the state probably before the next term is over in Congress. The answer is zero, absolutely zero. There is nothing that they know in the Department of Education that we can't read online and decide for ourselves here. And that's the difference. So many conservatives don't feel comfortable saying, well, the answer is zero because we all want to love children. I'm telling you, I visited the Department of Education. They may love children, but they do not love children more than we love our children here. 8% is all the funding that the federal government provides, and I promise you, they provide more than that percentage of the headaches. I wish Georgia would be the first state to say, you know what? Keep your money and keep your regulations too, and let us show you how it is to run an education system. Gwinnett County gets it, Forsyth County gets it, Washington, D.C. does not get it.
Look at what the state did. We have 57 states, depending on how you count them. But we have a bunch of laboratories where governments can look at local level and they can discover what the best way to fund your education. Now, there have been some issues with it lately, but the Hope Scholarship is one case where Georgia made it so that, you know, just about every student who had the decent grades could end up going to college, a state college, at no cost. Now, did the federal government solve that problem? No, the state does. So that's why I think the states and the counties, and even the local schools with charter schools and stuff, have the same ability to do those things much more nimbly and much more effectively than federal government.
Now, the question is, why does anybody trust Washington more than they trust their local folks? I've never understood that, because you can change your local folks. Maybe it's because you live in a Democratic state and you're a Republican, so you hope you can get a Republican voice in Washington. We've got to change our local level. Our school boards matter. Their authority matters. Their skill sets matter. I don't have any money out of a $3.8 trillion spending bill that I didn't take from Georgians to begin with. We could just leave it here, and we should.
Next question, Mr. Woodall. What will you do as a congressman to prevent states and municipalities from infringing on citizens' right to bear arms?
You know, the Second Amendment, one of the original 10 that had to be included or else the Constitution would not have been ratified. Critically important. There would be no United States Constitution without the Bill of Rights. It wasn't an afterthought. It was a package deal. You had to move them both together or you wouldn't have gotten either one. It provides limitations on what the federal government can do to citizens. You got to understand state rights, state legislative privileges are plenary. If the state of Georgia wanted to implement the president's health care bill, it would be perfectly constitutional. It's the feds that aren't allowed to do that. So you really get into some difficult Second Amendment landscape when you talk about what are you going to do to override state laws and regulations. This falls into that same category with gay marriage. You've got to be very careful about taking the principles that we know to be good and right here in Georgia and forcing every other state to live by the same rules that we live by.
Can you need me to repeat the question?
No, yeah. Go ahead and take a stand. Say that the federal government, well, certainly, absolutely, protection of the Second Amendment needs to be enforced. It needs to be upheld. It needs to be strengthened. It's a very clear one. It's not like one of those that there's even a question of, you know, what it says. It's just about 20, 30 words or something like that. I have to agree, though, that if the state of Georgia decided to do certain things, it would be a sticky situation as far as whether the federal government would come in and force the state to do something. I think states are sovereign, so powers are plenary, and that's where the powers should lie. So I think all that can happen at the federal level is absolutely protection and affirmation of the Second Amendment, and you know, the states fall whether it's New York and California and some of those Washington D.C. The district may decide they want to do something different, Chicago as well, but I think the federal government should probably be just a little involved.
And, you know, the first steps that we can take in that direction are doing away with those federal gun laws that are already on the books. I don't know when the feds got into the criminalization business, but criminalization happens at the state level, not the federal level, outside of a few national security issues like treason that the Constitution lays out for us. We don't need federal crimes, and we don't need federal prisons. We need state crimes and state prisons. When we start down that road, again, with folks who think that they know best, you never know where it's going to end. The law of unintended consequences is on steroids in Washington, D.C. We can begin to protect the Second Amendment by doing away with all federal control of gun laws.
Okay. The beautiful thing about the state is if you don't like what's going on, you can move. You can't really move very easily outside the United States. At least you can't take your money with you now because they can't even do that.
Let me take a little liberty. Given that recently the Supreme Court incorporated the Second Amendment into the 14th Amendment, so it applies to everybody. It is a congressional matter. Does that change your answer?
Well, it does not change my answer in that I think the court has been misreading the 14th Amendment for a long, long time, expanding it as it has the 6th Amendment. That's why we're in this health care debate. The dissenting judge in the Vinson decision coming out of Florida said, I may not be in favor of the health care bill, but Congress has so expanded the Commerce Clause, it includes absolutely everything now. And then the Necessary and Proper Clause includes everything beyond that, and then equal protection includes absolutely everything within that. The Second Amendment gives the federal government no authority whatsoever to regulate the people's right to keep and bear arms. That is a fundamental freedom that we can absolutely maintain. But within the states themselves, are concealed carry restrictions implicating the 16th Amendment? Are they, if it, the Second Amendment, are they implicating the police powers of a state? Those are legitimate questions for state governments to control.
Mr. Hancock?
Yeah, a large part of our problems are, as you mentioned, with the judicial branch. And that's where I go back to the point that each branch of government should not only making sure that it is doing its rights under the Constitution, but it should absolutely defend and guard against any other branch of government taking its rights, and it should also be monitoring the fact that other governments are overstepping their bounds. What the solution is education. Education of the voters, education of the people, and education, get the word out. When something happens, their congressmen right now, they stand up and make their voices heard. And that's what we need more of. We need more congressmen who are saying, this is wrong, this has got to stop.
Next question from Mr. Hancock. Did the Dodd-Frank Act, also known as the infamous banking bill, resolve the problems that led to the 2008 market collapse? And if not, what prevents it?
I think the Dodd-Frank bill was more of a reaction to what had happened. And I think one of the big failings, if you want to try to regulate one of the big problems we had with the financial incidents that happened in 2008, the Dodd-Frank bill doesn't even touch Fannie Mae or Freddie Mac. I think it was more of a reaction. It was once again congressmen and some senators who decided we have to do something to show people we're working, we're showing people we care about them. It created regulation on banks and businesses that I think are going to be much more harmful. And analysis I've read doesn't even look like, if it were followed, doesn't even look like it would have prevented what happened in 2008. So, I think it's a bad bill. I think the whole thing should be removed anyway.
Dave's exactly right. The beginning step with Dodd-Frank is not to improve it, it's to do it. Not only did it not solve anything, it made problems worse. It took too big to fail and made them too bigger to fail. The culture is suffering under Dodd-Frank is every community bank in this country. And they're being run out of business and incorporated into larger banks one by one by one. There were regulators on the job. It's what's so fundamental about my role as your congressman in Washington. My role is not to give you anything. It is to protect what you already have, which is liberty. But whenever somebody finds a problem, they think they're the smartest guy in the room and they can craft a federal solution for it. The feds created the banking crisis. They didn't solve the banking crisis, and they're going to make the next banking crisis worse. Repeal Dodd-Frank. Start with restoring our community banks. Local control works better than the financial sector as well.
Mr. Hancock, anything additional?
This is another case of congressman who decided that there's a crisis. I'm not going to go on a conspiracy to say they created a crisis, but anytime there's a crisis, they're quick to rush to create a law to solve the problem, or to make it look like they solved the problem. Every one of these things add regulations. There's right now, there's a federal regulations that people violate every day. They don't even know they're violating. And this is something that when there's so many regulations by so many different organizations at a federal level, that's where the problem comes. And everybody's such a rush to hurry up and make a federal solution, like you say, a one-size-fits-all solution, and that's not the answer.
There are 8 different federal regulatory agencies that regulate banks these days. Now, you think about the children in your household. Well, they do better with listening to one parent? They do better trying to answer to 8 parents or your boss. You need one boss to be responsive, or 8 bosses the better way to go. We are exacerbating these problems. If you find anything in your life that you think I know more about than you know about in terms of finding your happiness, or than that Mark or Jack knows about, come and tell me, we'll talk about that in Washington, D.C. 9 times out of 10, my job is to say, no, I won't do this at the federal level. I'll help you get it done locally at home.
We do want to close with one last question. You are running to be the Republican nominee for Congress. So we want to make sure that you've been involved with the Republican Party for some time and are supporting our values. So as we always like to ask our candidate, Mr. Hancock, who did you vote for in the 2000 presidential election?
I am voted, let's see, 2000, voted for John McCain.
In 2000?
2008,
voted for John McCain.
Okay, very good. Some people asked about that. We've had some interesting answers to that question before.
To be fair, though, I was a Huckabee guy in the primary, and my heart was set on fair tax champion Mike Huckabee.
General is what we're concerned about. We appreciate it very much. Thank you. At this point, we're down to our closing comments. Congressman Woodall, will let you lead off. You have a minute and a half of closing statements.
You know, the economy is number one. Job one. Getting folks back to work. Folks can't pay taxes if folks don't have paychecks. But the government does not provide jobs. I can succeed in passing legislation to make everybody in this room poor,
but I cannot pass legislation to make everybody in this room rich. We could go up to the federal budget today. If we paid Medicare, Medicaid, interest on the national debt, Social Security, those mandatory spending programs, we could zero out every other role the federal government performs, including national security, the Defense Department, Homeland Security, immigration, and the budget still wouldn't be balanced. We didn't get in this situation overnight. We're not going to get out of it overnight. But we have to make sure we're moving the ball forward on every single down. You will not find, and I hope you look at my voting record aggressively, a single vote that I have taken in Washington to push the ball backwards in the name of compromise. I'm not interested in compromising to move backwards. I'm interested in finding consensus that moves us forward. And every dollar the president and I can agree on to cut, I've said yes to and moved on. One of a handful of folks in Congress that have cut every single amendment they had an opportunity to cut, and proudly listed as one of the 13 freshmen that they say the Republican leadership can't control. Just to be clear, the Republican leadership may not be able to control me, but local Republican leadership here in town is who I work for instead. I appreciate you all doing this debate tonight. I appreciate you all caring enough to come out here 7th and 9th District candidate, and I appreciate David being so much a steward of this country that he put his name on the ballot and got in this race.
I did. I put my name on the ballot and got in the race. And one of the things that I would get from Congressman Woodall is I would just say no, you know. And I understand your 3 yards in the dust kind of thing, but I think we're at a time for a Hail Mary pass. I think I visualize it like there's a stage that is running toward a cliff, you know. Because most people in the back are just reading the paper and having a good time. They're seeing that things are going by pretty fast, but they aren't concerned. Some people looking out the window, seeing things are looking kind of bad. There are a few people who are looking up in front and seeing that. We've gone past the point now where we can deflect the horses a little bit. It's time to just, you know, cut the horses off the wagon or throw something in the wagon wheels or whatever we needed to stop it. And I think imagine if we had 300 new congressmen, one day in November, we wake up one morning, we've got 300 congressmen who've never been there before. And they aren't beholden to anybody. No lobbyist knows who they are. Washington would fall apart. The establishment would just be absolutely a tizzy. Those guys sit out their desk on day one. They say, oh, my job description? Let's see. Article 1, Section 8. Here we go. That's what they do. And that's what they do. And that's what we've got in the situation we've got where congressmen made a career of this. The congressmen have decided that they want to continue to make the friends they need to make in Washington. And I'm not. I want to be a citizen legislature. I want to go up there. I want to do the things for one term. Maybe two if I have to, and come back to my family and live in Georgia under the laws we passed. So.
Well, thank you, gentlemen. This has been thank you. It's been a good opportunity to get to know you more. I hope that folks in the crowd and get your friends involved. Please have them watch online. We have to know our congressmen. We have to know who these folks are and make sure we send them the right person to carry the football to continue the analogy. So we appreciate it very much. Our next debate will be at 7:30, we'll be taking a slight break. Thank you very much. Yeah. Thank you.
I don't know. feel like I'm wasting the people's time. I appreciate you being able to get them and be able to be on the YouTube. I think, you know, 1 minute goes fast.
Especially if she's only giving you 30 seconds. That's right. Afterward, she should have given me 30 seconds.